This video shows the geometric series, derives its convergence, and discusses how it converges in the complex plane. So the geometric series is a series of the form like so. And I'll set it equal to S, and R is some complex constant, n is an integer going from 0 to infinity, and S, if it converges, is some number. So the question, of course, is what is its value? What is the value of S? Well, there's a standard derivation of that, which is, of course, always worth remembering, and it goes something like this. Write out the terms of our series. Like so. And what is the value of a series? The value of the series is what you get when you look at the limit of the partial sums. So let's write down what a partial sum is. Let's take n terms, or at least terms to power n, rather. So there are actually n plus 1 terms here. And so the question is, what is this value? And the standard trick is to notice that there's a bit of a symmetry. If I multiply the whole works by R, then regroup and expand and all that. The last term, well, I've got the r to the n there, but I also get an r to the n plus 1. Now you will notice that this first block of terms in our sum, all but the last, were already present in Sn. And so you can say, well, you know, this is basically Sn without the leading one, and with an extra term, an r to the n plus 1, that wasn't there. So it's basically Sn, but without the first term and with a different last term. We can rearrange and solve for Sn then, which is kind of nice. So we can say Sn, bringing one of the terms on the left over to the one on the right, and I'm throwing in an extra minus sign just for fun. Looks a bit like this. And so if you rearrange things, solving for Sn, we'll get something like this. Now, this is the form that you perhaps would see in a calculus class or something like that. It's handy to rewrite this as two terms. The first one is going to be the limit, and the second is this guy right here. This guy right here, this is the difference between our partial sum, Sn, and the whole series, S. And so the question, of course, is what happens as n goes to infinity? So that's supposedly S, should it exist, and it's really entirely dependent on that term going to zero, or doing something, having a limit exist in some case, some sense. So if we look at that, let's take a look. The limit of the difference between these two guys, S minus Sn, is the limit as n goes to infinity of and if you look at this, you will notice the r's are constants. Let me pull them out. Okay. And at this point, the thing to notice is that we've been in the complex numbers all along, but we could have well been in the reals. Now it's kind of a worthy exercise to ask what happens as r goes to infinity, or n goes to infinity, rather. Does it matter if we're in the complex or not? Well, it kind of does. So notice that this limit as n goes to infinity of r to the n plus 1 is equal to 0 if the magnitude of r is less than 1 and is not existing otherwise and it definitely does not exist, or rather, it definitely is, has a magnitude plus infinity if absolute value of r is greater than 1. And there's some equivocation there about whether what happens when r is equal to 1 in magnitude. Because, for instance, if you're asking for r to equal the complex number 1, i.e. the real number 1, then you'll have a situation where it equals infinity, because you're just adding up a whole bunch of 1s in your series. But if you put up negative 1, you end up with an alternating sequence of 1s and minus 1s, and that doesn't exist. No limit there. So if r is equal to 1, but if r is equal to minus 1, this Sn is 1 minus 1, 1, or rather, not quite, it's 1, 0, 1, 0, no limits at all. So the conclusion then, we sort of wind this all back to the beginning about what is going on with this guy here. This is equal to something. It's equal to 1 over 1 minus r if absolute value of r is less than 1. It's equal to otherwise it is not finite. Now, the reason for putting so much effort into understanding the structure of this geometric series and its convergence is because it turns out that this drives a lot of the behavior of how the analytic functions have series, i.e. they're Taylor series, because they're power series, and the way that you test power series convergence is by way of comparison with a geometric series.